Good morning everyone. Today I'll be presenting seminar on immune checkpoint inhibitors. I'll be dealing under the following headings. Let's begin with immune system. The immune system is made up of network of cells, tissues and organs that work together to protect the body from harmful things like germs, viruses and diseases like cancer. To function properly, an immune system must detect a wide variety of agents known as pathogens, from viruses to parasitic worms, and distinguish them from the organism's own healthy tissues. After first finding a foreign substance, the immune system takes action on destroying foreign substance and abnormal cells, including cancer. Immune system comprises of humoral immunity and cell-mediated immunity. Humoral immunity, also called antibody mediated, in which B cells makes antibodies that identify and destroy foreign substances. Cell mediated immunity. Cell mediated immunity in which T cells identify and destroy abnormal cells, including those of which are cancerous. Now, introduction. The field of immunology and oncology have been linked since the late 19th century, when the surgeon William Coley reported that an injection of killed bacteria into the sites of sarcoma could lead to tumor shrinkage. Since that time, exponential advances in the understanding of the intersection between immune surveillance and tumor growth and development have led to broad therapeutic advances that are now being studied in all cancer types. Modern immunotherapy aims at upregulating the immune system to augment anti-tumor responses. Immune checkpoint inhibitors have emerged as one of the most promising forms of immunotherapy. Now coming to cancer immunotherapy. First, let's see what the history of cancer immunotherapy. In 1890, first cancer vaccine was developed by Cooley. Then in 1953, Cooley's work first got published. And from 1978 to 1985, there was enthusiasm phase in where 1960s adjuvant example BCG showed to eradicate some tumors. Then in 1976, immune components to spontaneous regression in melanoma. In 1978, tumor specific monoclonal antibodies were discovered, and then there was a skepticism phase from 1985 to 1997. Here in 1985, adoptive immunotherapy for patients with cancer and hybridoma methodology was discovered, and in 1986, interferon alpha approved as HCL cancer immunotherapy. In 1991, first tumor-associated antigen was cloned, that is MEK1, and in 1996, interferon alpha approved as adjuvant therapy. And from 1997, then begins the Renaissance phase. Here in 1998, interleukin-2 approved for renal cell carcinoma and melanoma. 2004, Avastin and cetuximab was approved. 2006, panitumumab was approved. And 2010, first cellular immunotherapy approved for prostate cancer. And in 2011, PEG interferon approved. Adjuvant imilimumab and anti-CTLA approved for advanced melanoma. Now, the utility of immune system. Our immune system is incredibly powerful. T cells are stimulated or modified to recognize tumors. Current state of cancer immunotherapy. There are multiple different platforms of cancer immunotherapy and many different target pathways. These are adopted T-cell transfer, that is TCR transfected T-cell, CAR therapy, non-specific immunotherapies like cytokines, CD40 agonist monoclonal antibody and T-cell receptor agonist, vaccination strategy that suggests Sipuleucel-T, MAKE-3, Oncovax, immune checkpoint blockade, that is CTLA-4 blocking monoclonal antibody and PD-1 blocking monoclonal antibody. Now let's see what are immune checkpoints. Immune checkpoints are small molecules expressed by immune cells that play critical roles in maintaining immune homeostasis and preventing immunity, autoimmunity. They are intrinsic down regulators of immune system. Potential checkpoint targets. The activating receptors which have agonistic antibodies and inhibitory receptors have blocking antibodies. Activating receptors are CD28, OX40, GITR, CD137, CD27, HVM. And inhibitory receptors are CTLA4, PD-1, TIM-3, BTLA, VISTA and LAG-3. Now let's see immune checkpoint molecules. There are two types, stimulatory and inhibitory. The ICOS or ICOS-L, action of it is to increase the T cell activation and cytotoxicity. GITR increases the T cell activation and decrease T regulatory cell functions. CD28 increase T cell activation. CD27 increase naive T cell proliferation and cytotoxic T cell differentiation. CD40 increase T cell and APC activation. OX40 increase T cell activation and T regulatory dysfunction or depletion. Now let's see about inhibitory immune checkpoint molecules. PD-1 decrease T cell activation and increase T regulator proliferation. CTLA-4 decrease T cell activation and increase T regulator proliferation. TIM-3 or galactin-9 decrease T cell activation and increase T cell apoptosis and T regulatory function. LAG-3 increase T cell expansion. VISTA decrease the activation of cytotoxic T cell and stimulate production of T regulator. BTLA-4 decrease T cell activation. TIGIT block T cell activation and increase tolerance of disease. And CD47 decrease APC presentation. Now this is the diagram is representing T cell activation and inhibition of checkpoint inhibitions. In this diagram, A is representing antigen presenting cells introduce the antigen presenting cells introduce the fragmented antigens to foreign bodies, presenting phagocytosed tumor cells to T cells via major histocompatibility complex and T cell receptor binding. This binding along with co-stimulation by B7 or CD28 receptor interaction causes T cell activation and further differentiation into cytotoxic cells and memory cells. Moreover, this process is hindered by an inhibitory checkpoint or CTLA-4 that takes place of CD28 in binding to B7, thereby blocking activation. Imilimumab is an inhibitor of CTLA-4 that can restore activation. Here in B, when activated, the cytotoxic T cell requires the interaction of its T cell receptor with MHC2 present on the tumor cell for response. Nevertheless, this too is blocked by yet another inhibitory checkpoint or programmed cell death protein 1, PD-1, present on T cells with its correlating ligand PD-L1 on the tumor cells. Inhibitors of either PD-1 or PD-L1 can be used to reverse this blockade. Immunoinhibitory receptors are expressed after normal MHC class 1 or 2 adopted T cell activation. Ligation of CTLA-4 by B7-1 or B7-2 or PD-1 by PD-L1 or PD-L2 attenuates normal T cell activation. CTLA-4 and PD-1 upregulation on chronically activated T cells makes them less responsive to antigenic stimulation. Inhibition of these targets can restore T cell function and enhance T cell tumor killing. Checkpoint inhibitors plays critical role in maintenance of peripheral T cell tolerance. Drugs that target immune system checkpoints have the potential to promote inflammation or antibody in autoimmunity in humans. Now let's see CTLA-4. Cytotoxic T lymphocyte antigen 4, CTLA-4 or CD152 and CD28 are homologous receptor expressed by both CD4 and CD8 T cells, which mediate opposing function in T cell activation. Both receptors share a pair of ligands expressed on the surface of antigen-presenting cells. They act at the level of lymph nodes in early immune activation. They were found to compete with CD28 co-stimulatory receptors in binding to B7 on antigen-presenting cells, thereby impeding immune activation. Imilimumab was the first antibody-blocking CTLA-4 approved for the treatment of patients with cancer. When compared to the standard treatments with chemotherapy, an increase in overall survival was noted with the use of anti-CTLA-4, especially in patients diagnosed with renal cell carcinoma, melanoma, and SCLC. In this diagram represent mechanism of T-cell activation. Figure A represent naive T-cell and unactivated antigen-presenting cell, which have no T-cell response. In figure B, we could see antigen-presenting cells activated by microbes or innate immune responses, which causes increased expression of co-stimulation and ligation by B7. Now the naive T cell release interleukin-2, which converts to effector T cells and causes T cell proliferation and differentiation. In this diagram, antigen-presenting cell presents the antigen to T cells. There is binding of B7 ligand with CD28, which causes co-stimulation and T-cell activation. Here CTLA-4, which is the immune checkpoint protein, blocks and removes B7. This causes lack of co-stimulation by CD28 and renders T-cell unresponsive. Now coming to PD-1 or PD-L1. PD-1 predominantly regulates effector T-cell activity within tissues and tumors. PD-1 is primarily expressed on mature T-cells in peripheral tissues and tumor microenvironment. This diagram is showing the role of PD-1, production of immunosuppressive protein. Here inhibitory ligand, that is PD-L1, binds to inhibitory receptors PD-1, which releases immunosuppressive cytokines, that is TGF-beta, which causes inhibition of T cell activation. PD-1 and PD-L1 are a later stage inhibitory checkpoint and its receptor respectively. Later stage means that the role is mostly in the subsequent stages of T cell response at the level of peripheral tissue. They represent an essential part of adaptive immune resistance. The expression of PD-1 and PD-L1 can be constitutive or induced. Constitutive expression is usually dependent on some oncogenicity-inducing factors or pathways such as MYC, KRAS, STAT3, PTEN, etc. Inducible expression usually relies on secreted inflammatory factors such as interferon gamma, TNF-alpha, interleukin-6, interleukin-8, and others. Inhibitors of PD-1 and PD-L1 have been widely used in number of malignancy with very good responses. Now let's see what are the differences between CTLA-4 and PD-1. Major site of action: CTLA-4 is secondary lymphoid organ, whereas PD-1 is peripheral tissues. Stage of immune response that is inhibited in CTLA-4 is induction or priming, whereas in PD-1 it is effector phase. The cell type that is inhibited is CD4 and CD8 in CTLA-4, whereas in PD-1 it is CD8 more than CD4. Cellular expression is by T regulator or activated T cells, whereas in PD-1 it is activated T cells. Main signals inhibited are competitive inhibitor of CD28 co-stimulation by binding to B7 with high affinity and removing B7 from antigen-presenting sites. And here in PD-1, inhibitor inhibits kinase-dependent signals from CD28 and TCR by recruiting and activating phosphatase following binding to its ligand PD-L1 and PD-L2. and role in T regulator mediated suppression of immune response is there in CTLA-4, whereas it's not there in PD-1. Now let's see other immune checkpoint inhibitors, that is lymphocyte activation gene 3 or LAG3. LAG3 is a transmembrane protein expressed on regulatory T cells and activated CD4 and CD8 T cells. LAG3 function as negative cellular regulator that binds MHC3 and is upregulated on exhausted T cells. The combination of anti-LAG3 and anti-PD-1 led to an improvement in CD8 T cell response. Moreover, a soluble LAG3 immunoglobulin has been studied in phase 1 trial in advanced renal cell carcinoma and in combination with chemotherapeutic agent gemcitabine paclitaxel in advanced pancreatic adenocarcinoma and metastatic breast carcinoma respectively. In addition, in a phase 1 trial, soluble LAG3 Ig in combination with peptide vaccine have been studied in advanced melanoma. Now the next is T cell immunoglobulin mucin 3, TIM3. TIM3 is an immune regulator that can induce T cell apoptosis or exhaust the immune system. It is found to be upregulated or exhausted cytotoxic T cells along with PD-1. Moreover, cytotoxic T cell with both TIM3 and PD-1 expression were found to be the most abundant non-cytokine producing lymphocytes. With an inability to secrete interleukin 2, interferon alpha and interferon gamma, TIM3 upregulation takes place during inhibition of PD-1 and PD-L1 pathway with checkpoint inhibitors. Now the next is V-domain Ig suppressor of T cell activation or VISTA. VISTA is a negative immune regulator that is mainly expressed in hematopoietic tissues. It is found in tumor microenvironment and stimulates the conversion of naive T cells into T regulators. Moreover, VISTA suppresses the activity of cytotoxic T cells and reduces the production of interleukin 10, interferon alpha and interferon gamma. T cell immunoreceptor with Ig and ITIM domain, that is TIGIT. TIGIT is a co-inhibitory receptor of Ig superfamily correlated with CD28. It is mainly found on NK cells, exhausted T cell, effector, helper, memory and T regulators. TIGIT usually binds two types of ligands, CD155 and CD112, which are expressed on APCs and T cell competing with CD226, thereby inhibiting the activation of T and NK cells. In patients with melanoma, TIGIT blockers used with PD-1 inhibitors improve CD8 tumor infiltrating lymphocyte production, cytokine production and degranulation. TIGIT is among the T cell receptor that interacts with a protein expressed by antigen presenting cells to send inhibitory signals to the immune system. This regulated interaction between the TIGIT and its ligands serves to suppress immunity when under attack from cancer cells, similar to the activity of PD-1 and CTLA-4 pathways. BNT lymphocyte attenuator 4 or BTLA-4. BNT lymphocyte attenuator is yet another receptor in IgG superfamily that is expressed not only by naive and activated BNT cells but also by monocytes and DCs. It binds to a receptor on tumor cells and tumor-related endothelial cells called herpes virus entry mediator, which is in fact part of TNF family. Upon the interaction of BTLA and HVEM, bidirectional signaling takes place where BTLA expressing cells are inhibited with their proliferation and cytokine production halted, and HVEM expressing cells, mainly tumor infiltrating lymphocytes, are stimulated with their survival potential enhanced. Multiple studies have shown a significant role of BTLA blockade in boosting the T cell response and anti-tumor inhibition when combined or not with PD-1 inhibitors. Now let's see what is dysregulation of immune metabolism at host level. First, obesity. Obesity is a complex disease characterized by excessive adipose tissue with dysfunctional adipokine signaling. Obese patients usually have lower level of anti-inflammatory, anti-apoptotic peptide adiponectin and higher level of pro-inflammatory cytokines such as interleukin-6 and TNF, as well as higher level of leptin. It was shown that obesity usually entails a chronic state of cytokine-driven low-grade inflammation implicated in T-cell exhaustion with decrease in NK cells and CD8 T-cells but increase in PD-L1 expression. It is well known from the previous studies that a high BMI is usually associated with worse survival in cancer patients. However, a few recent studies have shown a positive correlation between the BMI and survival, a phenomenon called obesity paradox. Now, calorie deficit. Calorie restriction improves immunosurveillance and protects against T-cell senescence via the suppression of insulin-like growth factor 1, interleukin-6, as well as decreased mTOR signaling and decreased anti-OX40 immunotherapy response. Study shows improved immune cell adipose tissue signaling after caloric restriction with better glucose tolerance and greater fat loss. Moreover, intermittent fasting was correlated with substantial improvements in response when combined with chemotherapy and immunotherapy. Gender effect. Some differences in PD-L1 expression, LAG-3 and IDO1 were noted between males and females that could affect the response to immune checkpoint inhibitors according to gender type. Many meta-analyses were performed to try to analyze the effect of gender and differences on the response of immune checkpoint inhibitors. Some of the studies reported that the overall survival with anti-CTLA-4 treatment could be shorter in females than in males. Microbiota. The intestinal microbiota has been a hot topic lately since its role in immune checkpoint inhibitors response have been investigated. Some studies have reported that the microbiota plays a role in immune surveillance by interacting with tumor antigens. The composition and diversification of gut microbiota plays an important role in the response to immune checkpoint inhibitors, as shown by Frankel et al., who reported that patients who have bacteriocidase in their gut flora had better responses to immune checkpoint inhibitors. The use of antibiotics 30 to 60 days prior to the treatment with immune checkpoint inhibitors and the use of proton pump inhibitors have been shown to have a deleterious effect on immune checkpoint inhibitors AKC. Now let's see what are the FDA approved immune checkpoint inhibitors. This is the list of FDA approved immune checkpoint inhibitors, the molecular targets and indications. First, deal with Imilimumab, the molecular target of which is CTLA-4 and it is indicated in metastatic melanoma. Nivolumab, molecular target is PD-1, the indication is metastatic melanoma, renal cell carcinoma, Hodgkin's lymphoma, urothelial carcinoma and colorectal cancer. Peprolizumab, the molecular target is PD-1 and it's indicated in metastatic melanoma, Hodgkin's lymphoma, urothelial carcinoma and gastric, PD-L1 gastric and gastroesophageal junction adenocarcinoma. Atezolizumab, the molecular target of which is PD-L1 and the indication is metastatic urothelial carcinoma, and Avelumab, the target is PD-1 and it's indicated in metastatic Merkel cell carcinoma and urothelial carcinoma. Durvalumab, the molecular target is PD-L1 and it's indicated in urothelial carcinoma. Cemiplimab, the molecular target is PD-1 and it's indicated in squamous cell skin carcinoma. And this combination of Imilimumab and Nivolumab, the molecular target is CTLA-4 and PD-1 and it's indicated in metastatic melanoma and RCC. Now let's deal with some selected immunotherapeutic agents in clinical trials. Lipimumab or Yervoy, the target, molecular target of which is CTLA-4 and it is indicated in melanoma, non-small or small cell lung cancer. Tremelimumab, molecular target is CTLA-4 and it's indicated in melanoma. And nivolumab, the molecular target is PD-1 and it's indicated in melanoma. And pembrolizumab, molecular target is PD-1 and it's indicated in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, Hodgkin's lymphoma, multiple myeloma and acute myeloid leukemia. Pembrolizumab, the molecular target is PD-1 and it's indicated in HNSCC. PD-L1, the molecular target is PD-L1 and it's indicated in various cancers and selected advanced malignancies. The companies which will deal with the production of immunotherapeutic agents are Bristol Myers, Pfizer, CureTech, Merck and MedImmune. Now let's see what are the adverse effects, also known as immune related adverse effects. Incidence is more than 50%. Onset is often delayed by several months. Most side effects of these drugs revolve around excess immune activation, that is type A adverse drug reaction. Life-threatening hyperimmunity is possible. These are the following adverse effects. Neurological adverse effects are posterior reversible encephalopathy, neuropathy, Guillain-Barré syndrome, myelopathy, autoimmune encephalitis, aseptic meningitis, myasthenia gravis, transverse myelitis and non-specific symptoms like headache, tremor, lethargy, memory disturbances and seizures. Respiratory adverse effects are cough, dyspnea, laryngitis, pneumonitis, bronchitis, pleuritis and sarcoid-like granulomatosis. Renal adverse effects are tubulointerstitial nephritis, acute renal failure, lupus nephritis, granulomatous lesions and thrombotic microangiopathy. Hematologic adverse effects are autoimmune hemolytic anemia, red cell aplasia, thrombocytopenia, leukopenia or neutropenia, acquired hemophilia and myelodysplasia. Dermatologic adverse effects are rash, pruritus, mucositis, psoriasis, vitiligo, bullous pemphigoid, Stevens-Johnson syndrome and breast syndrome. Ocular adverse effects are uveitis, conjunctivitis, scleritis, optic neuritis, blepharitis, retinitis, peripheral ulcerative keratitis and Wogt-Koenig-Harada syndrome. Cardiovascular side effects are myocarditis, pericarditis, pericardial effusion, arrhythmia, hypertension and congestive heart failure. Endocrine adverse effects are hyper or hypothyroidism, hypophysitis, adrenal insufficiency and diabetes. Gastrointestinal side effects are diarrhea, gastritis, colitis, ileitis, pancreatitis and hepatitis. Rheumatologic adverse effects are arthralgias, myalgias, inflammatory polyarthritis, psoriatic arthritis, oligoarthritis, vasculitis, Sicca syndrome, sarcoidosis, inflammatory myositis, resorptive bone lesions and fractures. Immune-related adverse effects are most commonly fatigue, rash, hypothyroidism and hepatotoxicity. These are the most common ones. And CTLA-4 specific are colitis, endocrine disorders, skin rashes and hypophysitis. And PD-L1 specific are non-specific arthritis, Sicca syndrome, pneumonitis and myocarditis, which is rare. Let's summarize all immune checkpoint inhibitors. Immune checkpoint protein, that is PD-1, this is an immune suppressive checkpoint. The synonym of it is CD297. Cellular expression is activated T cells in peripheral tissues, B cell, professional APCs and NK cells, and the ligand is PD-L1 and PD-L2. LAG-3, that is immunosuppressive checkpoint, synonym is CD223, and cellular expression is on activated T cells and NK cells, and the ligand is MHC class 2. TIM-3, which is immunosuppressive checkpoint, the synonym is HAVCR2. cellular expression is activated T cells and tissues such as liver, small intestine, thymus, spleen, lung muscle and brain tissue. And the ligand is mainly galactin 9 as well as phosphatidylserine and HMGB1. CTLA-4, which is immune suppressive checkpoint, and the synonym is CD152. Cellular expression is mostly knife CD4 and CD8 T cells and T regulators, and the ligand is CD80 or B71 or CD86, that is B72. KIRs, that is immunosuppressive checkpoint, and the synonym is CD158. The cellular expression is mainly NK cell but also APCs and tumor associated CTLs, and the ligand is MHC class 1 molecules. GITR, immune activating checkpoint, synonym is CD357, and the cellular expression is T regulators, activated CD4 and CD8 T cells, and the ligand is GITRL. And then 41BP, which is immune activating checkpoint, synonym is CD137, and the cellular expression is activated CD4 and CD8 T cells, T regulators, activated NK cells and neutrophils, and the ligand is 41BBL. Now, as to summarize, the pace of discovery in the fields of immunology and cancer biology is accelerating due to the foundation laid decades ago. As our understanding of the role of immune system in tumor initiation, progression and metastasis evolves, continued progress is likely in the treatment of malignancy. Checkpoint inhibition has already become a primary treatment modality for patients with broad diversity of cancer, resulting in significantly prolonged survival in some patients. Trials exploring other malignancies and a wide variety of immunotherapy combinations are in progress and should extend these results. Researchers and clinicians have developed great expectations for immune checkpoint blockade in the field of oncology. Based on witnessed remarkable patient responses and prolongation of life with plateauing in previously assumed death-doomed malignancies. With great enthusiasm for encompassing a larger population of possibly treatable cancers using immunotherapy, significant work has been implemented to turn immunotherapy-resistant tumors to immunotherapy-sensitive ones. A lot of studies are underway to try to apply these strategies of resisting the resistance to immunotherapy in clinic and to further the possibility of making advanced cancer a largely treatable disease. The future prospects can be effect of concomitant immunotherapy, immunosuppressive therapy or tumor response, potential biomarkers to predict immune-related adverse effects, and optimal preventive and treatment strategies for patients with underlying autoimmune diseases. These are my references. Thank you.